for us tonight, talking about courage, bringing us, inviting us to be courageous, right? Love is courageous because love breaks any barriers, right? Breaks anything, any obstacles that we have in our lives. So on that note, we pass the word to Paula to talk about love, reflections on love.
Good evening. It's and thank you for coming in during this Arctic blast. So I think our intention this evening is to get as warm as we can inside and light the fires in our heart. I'd like to give you first, before I get into my topic, my backstory of why I'm standing here in front of you. I read an article in the New York Times about this book, and I was intrigued, so I got it, of course. The Year of Yes by Shonda Rhimes. Shonda Rhimes is the creator of Grey's Anatomy, so some people that love that show will know of her and some other TV shows. But what struck me was that her sister said to her, "You always say no." So she said to herself, well, how about if I have a year of yes? And what's so powerful about this simple thought of having a year of yes is that you get to do your fears. What's a fear? Something to be examined, something to be tested, and hopefully something to be walked through. So here I am, by myself, doing public speaking. When I was working as an elementary school counselor, I was researching something called a stress scale. And they have them for children and they have them for adults. What it is a very simple list of how many stressful events you may have gone through in the last year. And what research psychologists predict is if you have a very high stress score, let's say someone close to you died, you moved, I mean, moving is a good thing, but that's involved stress, then the higher your score, the more likely you were to have some physical or emotional difficulty in the 2 years after. Well, what was curious to me when you put these events in order, you might think the dying would be at the top of the list for adults. It wasn't. It was public speaking. So this is a big event. After I get through this, I think dying will be easy. And another key thought that's really helped me on this subject of fear, about 40 years ago, and this is how time flies in your adult years, I was taking a summer program. It eventually turned into the Omega Institute, if people are familiar with that adult learning center in Rhinebeck, New York. So we were up at Bennington College in Vermont, and it was a wonderful week. We had five different spiritual teachers representing major religions. So you studied with one teacher. The end of the week, we had this incredible celebration with the Buddhist, the Christian, the Sufi, the Hindu, all up together making this Khan celebration. But my takeaway from that week was really a breakfast companion, because we'd get together, we stayed overnight and have breakfast together. And someone simply said, your fears are your hidden talents. And that also caused me to take a look at a fear and think about it. And I did remember as a child, I couldn't learn how to swim. My mother signed me up for group lessons, but somehow there was some bug in the water. I could not put my face in the water. So if my mother would have quit there, I never would have learned how to swim. But she was determined, and she got me private lessons. And today, if I wasn't a swimmer, I would not be as happy and content as I am. So I guess these are just little advertisements to think about what scares you in your life and consider breaking it down and trying it. So let's get to the topic today, reflections on love. I would say you would easily guess why I picked love, because tomorrow is... Yeah, this is a good group. No one is shocked and has to run out and buy chocolates or roses, you know, after tonight's talk. So it really is not... maybe you do, it's okay. It's really not a commercial ploy just to sell cards and candy and roses. It really is a time for us to go deeper into love. Now, historically, as far as I could find out, it's celebrated in Western countries. And it goes back to early Christian martyrs. And then we have that cute little cherub that shows up somewhere in mythology in the Middle Ages, running around with an arrow. Now, Cupid was born from Venus, the goddess of love, and also from Mars, the god of war. So you get a clue now on what love is going to be like. And, right. And as Leo said, you do need courage. It's so much fun to fall in love when you're young, and it could be with your first puppy or your first date. And I'm not saying it's not great to fall in love when you're 85, too, but you have more of an understanding about the stages of love and how it keeps on evolving. And then the word reflections. Well, the first image that comes to my mind is moonlight on a lake. And this is close because we have the sun setting at a beach. And what happens then is the light slowly goes into the water. So reflections to me mean gentleness, deepness, unfolding, nurturing. So as we reflect on love, we should have a better feeling for it, not just an idea about it. And my hope this evening is I will be sharing thoughts from inspirational thinkers, but also will be doing activities. From all my years in education, I realized that it's really important that we generalize what we learn, that we integrate into our daily life these wonderful ideas that we may hear in the classroom, or if children were working one-on-one with a speech therapist or a counselor, how do they take what they get from that intensified learning out into the world and use it on the playground or use it in the cafeteria? So tonight we'll be doing some of both. Now, the other thing that comes to mind when I think of the word reflections is mindfulness. Mindfulness, fortunately, I hope is becoming a household word now, because you'll see it in Time magazine, it'll be on television now. Mindfulness is really simply what you're doing right now. You're right here. You're listening. Hopefully you're not, you know, figuring out your checkbook balance somewhere in some part of your mind now. Because the more we come into the present moment and we're right here, we are actually taking a break from worry and thinking about the future and all the things that our mind has to catalog and get through in a day. And some interesting research came out of England. It was 2014 in the British Journal of Psychiatry. The people who participated in a mindfulness group, you can do that. You would go once a week and you would practice these mindfulness skills, learning how to watch your thoughts, not get caught up in them. In other words, kind of step back, and then when you got off again, you would learn how to come back to your breath or something else. Their experience in a 6-week mindfulness group was just as effective as people who went to a cognitive behavioral therapy group, which is really impressive because they both had a decrease in symptoms of depression and anxiety. And cognitive behavioral therapy is great. Again, it teaches you about your thoughts and how to make a different choice and how to change something into an affirmation and to see if you really do overreact to things or you're always looking at life through a dark lens. But also mindfulness. And to me, mindfulness is really generated from the heart. And that's what we're here tonight, to honor our thoughts, but to try to spend more time in our heart, in our feelings. I thought we just touched this. Okay. Okay. This is fun. I just found this in the New York Times this week. But to figure out why I even put this up here, let me just give you a little quick summary on the field of psychology. Psychology was developed really to help sort out men in the army for different jobs. And what they did was develop the IQ test, which is really what psychologists are associated with, giving tests and trying to figure out your skills and your weaknesses. So as the field of psychology developed, it really modeled medicine. And what happens is we look for what's wrong. And in fact, to this day, psychologists follow a medical model. We have to look up something in a book and come up with some kind of disorder. And then we give it a name and a number, and then you can get health reimbursement. And that's all fine. I mean, if you're arm is really hard hurting, or you're really sad when you wake up in the morning, you need to go to a qualified practitioner, find out what it is, but the most important thing is you need to change it. And we call that a treatment plan. But back in the 70s, we started with something called transpersonal psychology. And we started developing these skills of visualization and thinking about who I really wanted to be in positive terms. And the psychologist that really showed that the best was Abraham Maslow. He had a famous triangle that what all human beings want first is security and safety. They also want to eat well and have a nice, comfortable home, and then make friends, have a sense of belonging, find meaningful work. So every day they come home and they feel satisfied they're helping the world. But way up at the top of the triangle was something he called self-actualization. That means you can really evolve and strive for some higher things, to even develop your compassion, you know, your gratitude, forgiveness. So there are a lot of other things there. And that, therefore, opened the door for the newer field of positive psychology. Because all of us can try to concentrate on what's right and intensify that. And that's a good counterbalance to what we're dealing with that we think is wrong with this. So this was amazing that this came into the New York Times just this week on the 10th. So look who is going to now try to top the world in joy. It's the United Arab Emirates in Saudi Arabia. So I went through, I love to highlight, so I tried to pick out the important things. But right now, they lead the world in the biggest indoor ski slope, the largest man-made building, and they also have the fastest roller coaster. And now that they have given their people, like Maslow, the basic services of health and education, they get that guaranteed. They now have decided they want to go, I guess, further up the triangle. The government feels that after giving basic services, we should strive for higher goals. It's the beginning of a new journey of achievement and giving to the people, and we ask God to help us serve and take care of them. So they have a minister of happiness. They're not quite sure what the person's going to do yet, but the first step is starting the job. And then the other minister they've created is a minister of tolerance. So they prioritize those two things within their culture. They weren't the first country to start to speak about happiness like this, because in 1972, over here, the Himalayan Kingdom of Bhutan came up with gross national happiness instead of a gross national product. And they said currently the minister's kind of not pursuing it. And the other interesting thing here was I wasn't aware that every year maybe or so many years they do a world happiness report and they rank countries on who's the happiest. So number one this year is Switzerland. And we are 15.
That's great.
We're somewhere. We're not down at the bottom, though. Israel is 11. So Israel is the happiest country in the Middle East. And then Saudi Arabia turns out to be the happiest Arab country. And in contrast, Egypt is 135, because you know there's a lot of turmoil in Egypt now, and they're worried about jihadist activity. And then Syria is 156. They said there are only three under Syria. I'm not sure who's under them, but it might be interesting to look that up sometime and see the whole ranking. So let's go back to our positive thinking psychologist again, because this really makes me feel good. All of these traits, if we like research, we'll have to trust this psychologist, and this is his book, have been researched to promote well-being. So you can see I even found something in the dollar store, this nice words and words and words. And I think I've even seen things in home goods where you can buy something for your house and it has an inspiring word on it. Because the more you pass that word, you're going to be bringing it into your consciousness. I think one time I was swimming in a Mac, and on each pillar where I swam, it was like perseverance, endurance. So every time I swam, that word kept coming in. So this list here is just for you to, you know, look at with me right now. And Kirsten has really been helping us with gratitude, and that's a whole series of talks she's been giving. Kindness and altruism. Kindness does matter. I have a bumper sticker on the back of my car, and sometimes people talk to me in gas stations. Yeah, we agree, kindness does matter. Mindfulness, we've just spent a little time on. Self-compassion, we're going to do an exercise on that. A lot of times the last person we give love to consciously is ourself. And we know how important that is. We're very busy taking care of everyone else, but how much time do we nourish ourselves? Connection. You know, we're connected right now. Optimism. I think what really helped me through a lot of the things I've gone through in my life is whenever I hit some toughies or some big challenges, the question I ask is, what do I have to learn from this? There's got to be a gift in here somewhere. You know, because we really do grow through the tough challenges. It's not that we want them all the time. But we might as well just kind of say, okay, here we go. What am I going to learn from this? Forgiveness, we know how important that is. I think once I thought if we really got gratitude and then we really got forgiveness, we'd be walking around pretty free. We wouldn't be carrying resentments and have these leftover things. And savoring, what a nice word. It makes me think of French cuisine, but it just means that we ought to really, again, slow down and really enjoy what we have. Harnessing strengths and finding flow. So in order to practice staying in this positive energy field, I want to just share, we could use words around the house. When I was teaching families how to run family meetings, which is a once-a-week meeting that we get together and discuss things, one idea that came up was a good news box that you could just make at home. And that means during the week, you would just write something positive about another family member and drop it in. And then once a week, you'd open the family mail. And all these good tidings would come out. And even our Declaration of Independence talks about the pursuit of happiness, so we're working on it here. Is anyone a fan like myself of Doc Martin? A few women. Oh, okay, and a husband. Good, okay. Well, I guess I better say who he is, because most people here haven't watched it. But it's a public TV show, and it's in a beautiful coastal town in England. It's gorgeous. And the character of the doctor, I mean, he's excellent. You'd go to him right away for doctoring, but not for bedside manners. You know, he's really gruff, and somewhere in his development, he missed social skills. But he did fall in love with the beautiful teacher, and they did have a child, and now they're separated. So why I'm excited is we have a really competent therapist on this TV show. And that makes me feel good, because I've seen the opposite in some movies I've watched at different times. So she gave them homework to do their first therapy session together. And that was to just spontaneously hug 3 times a day out of the blue, just do it, and say something positive. Well, that you should have looked at his face when he said, I've got to come up with a positive. I mean, it wasn't just that he wanted to try with her, but that was not his nature. So in order to show how you do the positives, I'm going to have Kirsten help me. Yeah. All I want you to do is stand up and hold this heart so we all can see how big a heart she has. So what I'm going to do is something that in child psychology we called strength bombardment. I'm not sure if I'd use the word bombardment, but I'll try not to think military. So what I want to do is just speak to Kirsten now, right from my heart, and tell her I really appreciated your help with preparing my talk tonight. I realize you have a very busy life with multiple needs with family and work, and you were very generous with your time. I see you as a skilled speaker, and your sharing your journey with me helped a lot. I am so grateful.
I need to respond.
No. And that's how simple. That's good to clap for Kirsten. That's how we light up when someone comes along and just says something positive. You know, it can be a simple thank you, but it's really beautiful. And I'm just encouraging that we try that as much as we can. Okay. Ah, it worked. Perfect. All right. This is one of my favorite books. So the first question is, why is this child holding a loaf of bread when the child is going to sleep? Well, this goes back to the time that, unfortunately, in World War II, England was being bombed. It was a blitz, and it was not easy. And children were being separated and orphaned. And then other people were taking the children in. But these children who had been lost in the war and really dealt with not eating could not fall asleep at night because they were still panicky that there would be nothing to eat in the morning. So some creative soul gave the child a loaf of bread, and then it was easy for the child to go to sleep and wake up. So I'm sharing this process with you because I think it's another way that we can incorporate focusing on the positive, but you also can see the opposite question comes up, and doing it as a daily practice. This last person here didn't put his initials, but he is a Jesuit priest. And St. Ignatius, that founded the Jesuit order, was really close to St. Paul in that they both were living a worldly life. St. Ignatius was in the war, and I think he sustained some type of injury. And in the process of recovering, something happened. He had an epiphany. He transformed. You know, he was actually well off. So he just went off and founded the Jesuits and became a great teacher and healer. And he developed spiritual exercises. One of them, the examine is modeled off of. That means at the end of the day, you just reflect back on the day's activities. And it could be as simple as just asking yourself the first question. What was I most grateful for today? What a sweet way to fall asleep. Just concentrating and remembering that. You could do it at dinner time with family members. You could do it just all by yourself. And then the second one would be, if you want to extend it, it would be the opposite. What was the least grateful thing that happened? But then you have the chance to practice forgiveness or compassion. There are lots of things you can do because we still need to note what works for us and what doesn't work for us. And then there are more questions that are given in the book that you could follow because we like variety. But I think if you can just remember most grateful and least grateful, that's a quick one. sense of belonging, didn't, happy, sad, high point, low point. You can use your own words. It's just a way of remembering to do it. Now that was too much. I pressed too hard. Now I'm going the wrong way. Nope. I want the next one. Thank you. We did the simplest technology for me, but I have to still practice how strong my finger is when I press. So this next exercise I love, and this is one we're just going to do together. But this is a way to get in touch with your heart, and it came out of a research center in Boulder Creek, Colorado. I'm not Colorado. I always want to do that with Boulder, but it's Boulder Creek, California. And they've been researching the electromagnetic energy in the heart for at least 20 years. So really, there are these things that can be read by machines, magnetic energy fields, that, like right now, Kirsten and I are sharing. We're all sharing in this room. So that's kind of like when you smile when you meet somebody, because you're being enhanced by the energy coming from that person. Or just like we like to be around an elevated spiritual figure, they are honestly lighting up the room. They're generating such a field of energy out of their heart that we're just swimming in it. But it's something that we can do, and in fact, I did this the other night at the Easy Bank, because I'm finding that it doesn't take time, you just have to remember to do it. And there's all these moments throughout the day that are just fill-in time. It could be really a long red light. So what I suggest is, you can see the steps. I am going to ask you to close your eyes if you're comfortable. If you're not, well, you can just look at our robot friends, and then maybe Daniel could play some really quiet music. I want you to feel how easy this is, and then it might be something that you decide to practice. So you relax and take some deep breaths. We know when we slow down our breathing, we are nourishing ourselves. It's also the opposite of stress. And I want you to go to your heart, just with your attention. And sense your heart. It's really a feeling. It's like getting into your heart. And when we're real quiet, we'll probably hear it beating. And feel how good it is just to rest in this heart energy. And now what you do is you send feelings and love of love and appreciation to yourself. It's really good to hear how much you love yourself, how much you approve of yourself, how much you care about yourself, what a strong effort you're trying to do good in the world. So just bathe yourself in this beautiful heart energy. It's like going to the well, and now everything's all right with the world again. While we're resting in the heart, I'm going to extend this beyond what the steps are up here, and I would like you to send this love to someone you love. It could be an animal friend, a person. It could even be someone who's passed on. But just bring to your heart someone you love and see the energy from your heart being sent to that person. The next thing we're going to do is to send this love to someone who is neutral. I usually pick the person who waited on me in the grocery store, or someone that you might have passed at work. So send this nourishing love to someone neutral next. And for the last person, pick someone difficult, someone that you're really having to adjust to. And if we follow Louise Hay's suggestion, if this is hard to send love to this person who's difficult, you could picture them as a little child. Sometimes that happens. And then you can just enjoy the music for a minute and feel this beautiful energy in your heart. And now, gently bring yourself back to the room at your own speed, knowing that you can return to your heart whenever you take the time to do this. So happy Valentine's Day. You've just gone to the most important place here on the planet, which is inside your heart. And just to extend this, what we did when we sent the love to someone we love, someone who was neutral and someone who was difficult, that really is called the loving kindness practice or the metta prayer that has been shared with us through mindfulness Buddhist teachers. And it's just beautiful. So I was at my osteopathic doctor this week and I was sharing with him my great endeavor this evening that I was going to speak. And he said, what are you talking on? And I said, voila. Voilà. And he said, guess what? I have one for you. He said, I was at a conference in a hotel in California, and there was this beautiful prayer, and they weren't giving it out. They only had one copy of it, so I took it on my cell phone. And he said, I'll send it to you on your cell phone, and I've learned enough now to be able to open that up and read it. So this is called the compassion exercise, just so you know there are variations on what we just did. So he said, this is done wherever people are congregating. You know, it could be in a shopping mall, it could be a grocery store, it could be an airport. But if you have 2 minutes and nothing to do, you could do the compassion exercise, which means you would select a person, an anonymous person in this group. Hopefully they wouldn't think you were trying to, engage them, because hopefully there are enough people, you can kind of gaze at them and you'll be safe. And what you do when you pick this person out, you say these sentences to yourself or something similar. Just like me, this person is seeking some happiness in his or her life. Just like me, this person is trying to avoid suffering. Just like me, this person has known sadness, loneliness, and despair. Just like me, this person is seeking to fulfill his or her needs. And finally, just like me, this person is learning about life. I mean, how beautiful, how simple, how nourishing. It's kind of like that person hits the jackpot. You selected that one random person out of this crowd and really nourished their day. And then with little children, this is so sweet. They, make it simple when you're working with younger children, and they can just say, may I be safe, may I be well, may I be at peace. May my parents feel the same way, my teachers feel the same way. And then when there was a mindfulness teacher working with preschoolers, they asked about why the ambulances emitted such a loud sound. And the teacher said, Well, emergency rescue workers are helpers, and the sirens mean they are going to help someone. So whenever we hear a siren, we can wish them well by saying, may they be safe. So I think we love all these ideas. I think what we do is remember to use them. And people now may have some practice when they have to stop on the road and a siren comes by, where they might say a prayer anyway. And then there's a very long version for children. And I gave Albita a copy, and then I'm going to give one to Yasko, because I think our two Spike teachers could do a variation of this. This longer prayer came from a meditation teacher I had years ago with three sons, and he wrote it, and he said it as a bedtime prayer with each son. And he was so gratified when the eldest son was a teenager, because he wasn't tucking him in anymore. But he heard the eldest son doing a variation of this. In other words, may I be free from suffering, may my family, may my teachers, may my brothers and sisters, may my neighbors, may the people down the block. So that is your loving kindness practice. All right, now I'm doing a 5-minute commercial break on health and fitness. Because we can never like leave this. To me, we're gonna have a healthy, happy heart, you know, if we're really taking care of our bodies. And Dr. Mark Hyman is, I brought one of his books along, The Ultramind Solution. He's also written on the blood sugar, heart health, anything you can think of in today's world. And he is part of a new trend in medicine called functional medicine. And that means that you can prevent or try to reverse some of these illnesses that we acquire through lifestyle changes. And that's very empowering. And it goes along with the talks we've had here on epigenetics. You're not just a product of your genetic inheritance. There's a whole lot you can do in how you perceive stress, how you work with stress, how much you move your body, what you eat. So he's a great resource. And so this is our 5-minute list. And with the eat whole real food, I don't know if anybody saw Michael Pollan's recent documentary on PBS, but he's really like the real food teacher. And this was a book he came out with, Food Rules, an Eater's Manual. And I love the centerfold. This is a great centerfold. It says, when you eat real food, you don't need rules. That means if you're eating closer to the source, like your ancestors did, and that really is a vegetable coming out of the ground, or the cow or the sheep really grazed in the field, you are eating high quality food. We're not saying what to do. I mean, he does advocate eating mostly plants and also eating less than you typically do, like even getting a smaller size plate. But the main thing is try to get wholesome, good ingredients. And that means somebody's going to probably be cooking again. And what else does he suggest? Address the underlying causes of stress. Well, outside of the things that we know happen just logically, you know, trying to earn a living at work, I think when I get a little more psychological, the personalities or the characteristics I think that can quickly do us in, the big one is codependency, which people are familiar with if they've gone to groups. And all that simply means is continuing to put other people before yourself. And not that we're not trained to be of service and to help others, and we're not going to stop that, but we really have to nourish ourselves. And I think the other big one is perfectionism. We're somewhere we really thought we had to do it all right all the time. And that was another contribution from this book, because she said in a college talk she gave, if someone tells you they're doing it perfectly, they're probably lying. In other words, we really have to ease up on ourselves. Move your body. I don't know if you've seen pictures of standing desks that people use at work now. In fact, I enjoy standing, especially this, more than sitting, because I'm moving and things are happening. A lot of people are wearing Fitbits now, so they're counting their steps in a day just to make sure they're moving a lot. Heat therapy, it's that wonderful hot bath again. It is so relaxing and it's really supportive. Rethink your beliefs. That's a good one, because sometimes we're not even sure what we believe, and that's why we share with other people and they mirror back to us our belief patterns. Find a community. You're sitting in one now. Now you know you're on a health list. Breathe. We just practice that. I think it's just remembering to take deep breaths and then meditate. And I don't want people to be scared by the word meditate, because it does not mean stopping your thoughts. It just means slowing down. And the easiest way to get into a meditative practice is really to do guided imagery, which is how we usually end meetings here. And we'll do that again tonight, where you hear like beautiful words and you go to a beautiful place. That is meditation. And of course, we have them on Divaldo Franco's healing CDs, and they do work. And then over time, when you get used to doing some kind of a concentration exercise, following your breath, staying in your heart, you'll find that it really is easy to learn how to meditate. It really is. Okay, let me see if I get to the next slide. Yes, good, it worked. I really can't give a talk without referencing Louise Hay. She has really been, to me, a prime contributor in me dealing with stress, feeling good about myself, finding a positive thing to say when I'm under stress. So I looked up in her book what a heart problem would be. And her definition of a heart problem is a long-standing emotional problem. So that just means that somewhere along the line, and we're all human beings, we kind of shoveled something away. We could have been real young, we could have been older. Again, it's no one's fault. But unless we take the time to kind of dig out from the inside and take a look at things that either scare us, frustrate us, make us angry, we don't want to set ourselves up for a heart problem. And a lot of medical people now in the newer functional medicine are saying that heart problems come more from inflammation than cholesterol buildup. So then I went back to Louise Hay because I thought, I wonder what inflammation is to her. And of course, it's so simple. She said that inflammation is fear. It's also seeing red and having inflamed thoughts. So now we're realizing how important it is to find these tools to find out what we're thinking, what we're feeling, and just move it on. And not to sit on them or try to put them in a box, because somewhere within our whole body-mind system, a toll is happening. It's affecting something. And then her, of course, wonderful contribution is after you've used like her book, Love Your Body, and you've looked up your physical condition, and she gives you this underlying reason, then she gives you your medicine, so to speak, your affirmation that you concentrate on. So I even was saying that preparing for this talk. It works. It really does. You know, it's just, I guess, being open to trying this. But I really do love her. She's a great contributor. So is my 5-minute commercial up? I think so. Okay, now you're saying, this is a spiritist center. Where are the spiritist thinkers for the topic on love? Now we're at the part where I am referencing. First of all, Emmanuel. And since I decided to show you everything at once so as not to confuse myself, here are all the quotes together. And I love the first sentence because there's our word reflection again. We really are love. Love is why we're here. Love is what animates the universe. The Beatles sang it, "All You Need Is Love." You know, it's a beautiful holiday tomorrow. And it's also where we get our wisdom and beauty from. And in the second quote, love shines through the soul of all major religions. It was just like that wonderful week I spent 40 years ago. You know, no one was worrying about each other's dogma. No one was worrying about how they practiced. We all found our common core, which is what Emmanuel is saying, you're seeking communion with divine goodness. And once the Dalai Lama said, if we only had one religion, it would be like having only one restaurant in New York City. I mean, everyone would be bored and tired. So it's okay to have different choices. We're all going to go to the same place based on your upbringing, your cultural heritage, or maybe what you discovered as a teenager or a young adult. You're going to put together the spiritual practice that makes sense for you. And even if you're still in the religion you grew up in, I'll bet you're seeing it a little differently and you're working on different practices. And this one I really love too. Because love is the silent hope of heaven, awaiting the evolution of all principles while respecting the decision of all consciences. So here we are at whatever stage of enlightenment or awareness, we've got our conscience, but somewhere in this ultimate scheme of things sits love. And love is just patiently waiting for us to grow, accepting everything we go through, the easy stuff, the tough stuff, it's all grist for the mill. We just trust that it's all going to work out somewhere. So this is a great book. I have to thank my friend Yasuko for this. She got it for me, and it's a recent one. It's 2014. And the last chapter is love, and the first chapter is called The Mirror of Life. Sometimes I just like to read chapter titles, and these books are so handy because they're not that long. Okay, let's go to our next Spiritist thinker. And here is our Spiritist psychologist, Joanna de Angeles. Now we're going to do a little bit of work. We love love being easy and nourishing, and that's really the truth of it. But here we are in our bodies, seeking to grow in relationships and not finding it easy all the time. So this first sentence to me, I don't really even need the rest of it. I really just want to sit with the first sentence. One person can only make another unhappy when that other already nourishes the conflict of inner disharmony. So let's just, this is the main thought that really does a lot for me. So I, since Kirsten's been my supportive assistant, let's pretend that she said something I didn't like. I mean, we're human beings. She could have been tired, she could have been rushing, and all of a sudden, inside myself, I'm hurt. It's like, I can't figure this out. Well, okay, fine, maybe she did do that, and that's, I'm not condoning it, and maybe she would say later, oh, I'm sorry, I would have rephrased that differently, but she's not the point. Kirsten really is not the point. The point is what's going on inside of me. In other words, this has only been a trigger to something I need to understand about myself. Now, doesn't that change the nature of conflict between two human beings? It doesn't mean that we're saying the other person didn't say or do it. What we're saying is what's going on inside of me. Now, I'm going to use Doc Martin one more time, even though only three of you besides me, I think, are avid fans. But in their next therapy session with this great therapist again, they agree that Doc Martin lacks social skills. He really is gruff. People do not like sitting in his office or dealing with him. So here's Louisa sitting here, and she's got the therapist confirming, yeah, this is a problem. This man really needs to get some new communication skills. But this is the great insight that ties into the first sentence. The therapist turns to Louisa, and she says, so do you find yourself often feeling disappointed, frustrated with Martin's behavior? She's going, wow, somebody gets it. They understand how I'm going through all this stress with this person. But it's not for her at that moment to concentrate on Martin's faults. It's for her to come back inside herself. So what the therapist then says is, it's possible that this is going on because you yourself have fears of intimacy based on her childhood. Whoa, if that isn't an eye-opener. So when we look on conflicts, I mean, sure, we can see it. We can say this person needs to learn A, B, and C. But really, the two people came together, especially in a, you know, a heartfelt, committed or partner marriage relationship, because both are somewhere at the same level with something. And so their job is to support and nurture each other to take that next step. So that gave her plenty to think about. He still needs better social skills, but she can try to figure out why she's hiding from a really good, healthy relationship by picking him, because they're both kind of stuck in the same range. Does that make sense? Yeah, good, good. So what Joanna goes on to describe then is immature love eventually making it up to mature love. And the way to get to mature love is to train your emotions. And of course, my favorite is to share your feelings, to learn how to understand the feeling, name the feeling, and say it. So instead of saying, you so-and-so, how could you think that way? How could you run around and do that? You own it for yourself. I'm really frustrated with this. I'm really disappointed. And then a whole new world of communication opens up, and nobody's like kind of getting into their defensiveness, but they're starting to come together. Okay. So let me get to the next one. All right. This is just a beautiful picture. It reminds me of my week with a different spiritual face. And I'm just going to leave this up because this is called a mandala or a yantra in India. And as I'm mentioning a few more spiritual thinkers here, if you just gaze into the center, that's a treatment already. It's a release of tension. You can use it as a focusing tool. In one of the elementary schools I worked in, we had children coloring mandalas when they were sent to the office because it was calming them down and focusing them. So this is a powerful visual tool. And I'm just going to leave that up while I mention a few of my other favorite spiritual thinkers here, watching the clock also. So I think I may speed this up. Pope Francis, one of my favorites, who's really talked about the year of mercy, and recently interviewed, someone said, give us your secret to happiness. And he said, slow down, take time off, live and let live. Work for peace, work at a job that offers basic human dignity, don't hold on to negative feelings, move calmly through life, enjoy art, books, and playfulness. So there goes Saint Francis. I want to call him Saint Francis already. He took the name of Saint Francis of Assisi, and we know he's active in Mexico right now trying to heal more things. The next spiritual teacher that I think is very powerful is Thich Nhat Hahn. Interestingly enough, last year, the year before, he suffered a stroke, a lot like the Brazilian route to share. And he's in recovery now in San Francisco. But remember, he taught us how to eat. And we tried this at one of the Spiritist summer camps where we were not to talk. Wow, that was hard. For the first 5 minutes of eating, to try to concentrate on the food and try to like clear our mind. So he has really left a lot of gems. And then in this magazine, I read an article that was written by the first woman to head up the Zen monastery in San Francisco. And she had a close friend who was dying, and they had always talked about death. And so she went to visit the friend who was dying, and she said something like, Blanche, do you have any idea what it's going to be like? Because they had decided the dying was a great mystery, but not anything to be worried about. It's just a mystery. So I think Blanche at that point was about a week from dying, but she like roused herself and she said to her friend, it's all about joy and love. That helps. If that doesn't change the whole understanding of it. And years ago, my father made friends with a priest who suggested that at funerals we wear white instead of black, because it was really celebrating the birth of the soul into the next existence. Okay, and I'm gonna be good here because I'm gonna go on to the exercise. The last person, I could not put up the Dalai Lama's face because he really is the religion of kindness. Interestingly enough, he's being treated right now too in like the Midwest. It's nothing serious, but we realize it kind of makes you sad in your human way that these great figures are aging, so things are happening. And he was interviewed by the head of Shambhala. It's a Buddhist magazine. And just Why does the Dalai Lama touch so many people, not just those that get to be with him, but those who see him or read his books? I think it's because he sees past all our differences and connects with the essence of who we are as human beings. He opens our hearts, touches our deepest longing for a life of happiness and affection. He makes us feel it's possible. And the last person I want to reference before we go on to closing activities is someone you might not have heard of, Richard Rohr. This is his latest book, Eager to Love, and it's based on the life of St. Francis of Assisi. And he is a Franciscan who runs a contemplation center in New Mexico. He's quite advanced in his understanding of the Catholic religion and spirituality. It's all very contemplative, peace-oriented. So he has a daily email that he sends out. And this one on grace I thought was really beautiful. It said, "Please don't get caught in your small stories. They are usually less than half true and therefore not really true at all. They're usually based on hurts and unconscious agendas that allow us to see and judge things in a very selective way. When we're hurting, we tend to get panicky. We lose our ability to stay in the present, and we go up into our heads and start obsessing and figuring it all out. Then what I really miss is not feeling myself anymore. I'm not grounded in my body. I'm not really in my feelings. I'm off doing something in my head. So then he suggests that we let go and rest in the big river that's flowing all the time. Not our little stories, but the big river. And that's where faith and trust comes in, because sometimes you really don't feel it. It's more like an abstract faith and trust. But if you can get in the river, if you realize it's behind this whole world and that it is good and it is going to take care of you, it doesn't matter what happens. In the end, you're just going to return to love. So he said you could ask yourself, it's kind of like where we started tonight with me sharing my backstory of the fear. He said questions you could ask yourself are, what am I afraid of? Does it matter? Will it matter at the end? Or in the great scheme of things, is it worth holding on to? But we have to answer that for ourselves. Okay. Yep. All right. Now this is going to be a very quick exercise because I see it's around 7. And I have 3 exercises, but we're going to get to do them. We'll just do them. Not a long time, but enough to feel them. This is a wonderful book. I don't know if you ever heard of her other book, The Not So Big House. This is a female architect who works in the United States and realizes that typically what Americans thought was important were big houses. You know, like windows you can't even reach to clean. I mean, these big entranceways and, you know, rooms for everybody and TVs for everybody. And we're not saying that if you have one, it's bad. But she designed very beautiful houses that were smaller, more compact, more creative, more sustainable, multi-uses. Like under her stairways, it's not empty space. You know, it's a sitting area or it's got storage boxes. It's beautiful. So if you're ever interested in the photography, it's great. It's the Not So Big House. Then she went on to do a little bit of philosophizing and she talked about the Not So Big Life and how, again, we can make things simple. And we can get ourselves more nourished. So the quick little exercise we're going to do, you're not going to close your eyes this time. All you're going to do, and I'm going to help the people like up front because I'm going to use a little aroma spray. All I want you to do now is to sense. You're in this room. I want you to just sense. There are lights and there's darkness. And there's textures in here, and there are colors, and there's smells. And you may be warm now, or you may be cold now. I almost feel like I'm a little child. I want to go back into my senses. I spend so much time in my head. I got the whiff of that lemon rose, too. Okay, now switch it and start in your mind just naming things. Podium, speaker. I'm with my friend, I don't know, picture. In other words, do what you typically do when you enter a room. You just note things. But you've got a name for everything. Maybe if your first language was Brazilian, you're doing it in Portuguese, but it's fine. What you're doing is organizing your world based on naming it. Okay, can you tell a quick difference from the two, whether you're... And how did you feel doing the first one?
Good, I guess.
Yeah, it was okay. Yeah. It was easy. And how did you feel doing the second one? Yeah, and I'm neither were bad. That's good. It was just a little different in your brain, wasn't it? Because you had to like go into what we call the left brain to start naming everything. And that's a different energy and activity than just being here. Like, it would be easier if somebody had just put a home-cooked meal on the table. I think we could go to our senses even more quickly. Okay, that's just an awareness exercise. Okay, now, here's one I love, and it's freeze frame. So, this was also developed by the same people that brought you Heart Lock-In. I feel like I'm like an advertisement for them. So, they also are bringing you the freeze frame technique. And this is some way that you can get yourself out of stress. The Heart Lock-In is just a pleasant place to go. You can use it, like I said, when you're stuck in the line. If you want to keep extending it out to other people, that's beautiful. But just do quick Heart Lock-Ins whenever you remember. And this one is when you would like to solve a problem. And I love this American poet, Mary Oliver. This is her latest book of poetry called Felicity. And this poem is called Don't Worry. Things take the time they take. Don't worry. How many roads did St. Augustine follow before he became St. Augustine? And our other one, they're all good in here, but this is good too. When did it happen? When did it happen? It was a long time ago. Where did it happen? It was far away. No tell, where did it happen? In my heart. What is your heart doing now? Remembering, remembering. So, in order to do and experience this exercise, which you're just going to do inside yourself again, you're going to have to bring up a stressful moment. It doesn't have to be major stress. It could have been just running late for something or somebody not showing up to give you something. And we're then going to take our attention and we're going to put it on a positive experience we've had. So you can see what happens, even if we're just using our left brain to analyze this and we're not in our right brain feeling it. We're going to move from this stressed out moment. We're going to make a sincere effort to jump out of this racing, obsessing mind, and we're going to first of all go to a happy place. I guess if I was with children, I'd call it a happy place. You know, I could be in a swing, I could be up in a treehouse. I'll probably remember a beautiful walk on the beach or maybe a dinner I just had with a friend. But you can see what you're doing. You're generating a whole different place. I'm not saying this problem left. The problem's here, but you're going to go inside and create a happy place. And then, once you're inside, you're back in that heart lock-in again. You're actually going to ask your heart a question. What? I can talk to my heart? I didn't know my heart talked. I didn't know my heart gave answers. I thought that was only my thoughts. But truly, your heart is the seat of wisdom and intuition. Intuition is something that we kind of know happens. You know, we hear it when a loved one might be sick and we know they're on the phone. But if we go there more often, then I really believe the intuition's going to get stronger. You're going to trust your hunches. You're going to trust your gut feelings. And you're actually going to say, my heart could give me the answer to a problem. Amazing. I mean, we thought the heart, which is the hardest. Oh, that's me. I believe in practical demonstration, so that was, I was just going to say, and I didn't have to talk further, it's my hardest working muscle. It just keeps thumping away. So this is it. This is called freeze frame. But in their work with people under stress, if you could actually follow these steps, and you can imagine, you could try it tonight. First of all, you've got to have the desire to move yourself out of the stress. And the happy place recharges you. Then the heart comes online, and you can ask the heart, what would be a more efficient response to this current situation or problem? And then wait to hear what happens. So I would say those of you that feel more comfortable with intuition, you followed your gut before, will find this pretty easy to do. To somebody else, it'll be a stretch. But even if the heart doesn't contribute yet, don't give up. It's just like waiting for someone to say something to you. It will eventually happen. Okay, so we'll let that one just kind of rest as a teaching one. And then we're going to go here. Okay, so we're going to finish up with deep listening. And I love this, too, for Valentine's Day. When another person really needs to be listened to, sometimes they will go on and on, usually in a superficial, nervous manner. But what that's telling us is because they haven't really been listened to. And they need it. It's amazing how people need to be listened to. Again, we're not solving a problem. We're not coming up with what to do. It's just the presence of another human being who is listening to you. When I teach communication skills, I call it reflective listening or active listening. So listening takes time. If you think of somebody at work that probably really needs your help, you may only have a minute, and that person may need 10. So you might be in a conflict as to whether you can actually stop the flow of work, go somewhere for, I don't know, water or coffee, and just sit and be there, this open heart, a container to let the other person go on until they have really let it out. Okay. And what happens is you do reflection. There's our favorite word coming back again. And this is a tough part for all of us thinking brains that are coming up with, you know, solutions. Let go of expectations, let go of judgments, and don't be defensive, and don't try to take over and control the situation. So I say we have time. It's about 12 after 7. And I think we have time to do this partner exercise. That'll take us up to 7:15, and then I'll find out if we want me to do the visualization or you want to do something else. So let me put the picture up. This is deep listening. The guidelines are simple. If Kirsten was going to be my partner and she was going to be the one to talk, I am listener, and this is the closest I can say to practical mindfulness, because I want to empty my brain of judgments and thoughts and, oh, Kirsten, why don't you try this? Or maybe this would be a nice way to handle it. I just want to stay with her heart to heart and hear what she has to say. No questions on my part. That's a toughie. No questions am I going to ask. But I might, just to signal that I'm with her, I might name her feeling once in a while. You're really frustrated, you're really disappointed, you're really confused. And that's it. That's all you have to do. It's very simple, but it's very deep and powerful. So if you just wanted, the simplest thing is just turn to the person next to you, and I don't know if you're gonna play music or just, I'll watch the clock. And just one person talk first, the other person be the deep listener, and then we'll just, I'll wave my, I don't know, say something, and in a minute we'll switch. I hope we're all still awake and we followed that, right? See how, I guess you, if there's two there, then we've got to do this. Well, you could listen. If you don't want to do it, then you could do it with her and she could listen. It doesn't matter. If you want to move over to her. Yeah, you can start. Whoever wants to start, go. Look at her. Look at her. But I'd like you to take turns and switch. Switch, let the other person talk and you listen, just switch. She should be talking. Switch. You talk now. Take another 5 seconds before we finish. I think I'm missing a bell. So if I could have an imaginary bell, maybe Daniel could turn off the music. That would be a sensory change in the room. So I'm sorry that we couldn't do that exercise longer, because it really is important. And I'm hoping that you could feel it when the other person's attention was on you, that you really were getting the attention you needed to talk about what was ever on your mind. The other person's not really interrupting questioning. They're just there with you. And sometimes naming a feeling helps the conversation go deeper. So we're going to finish the talk with just me showing a book I just found, Love is All Around Maryland. Now, if I were the kindergarten teacher, we'd all sit in a circle and I'd move each page and read the whole book. But since we're here tonight to celebrate Valentine's Day, I took this, I love the centers of books. Okay. I love Maryland. Let me do, how do you make that go dark? It doesn't matter. And then we'll have only one slide left. Okay.
Thank you. I was doing the other thing.
Okay. So, I love Maryland. You can see how love travels when shared with a friend. We just did that. If everyone shares love, it never will end. I think this rhymes too. From one to another, it spreads and it grows. You can't have too much, as everyone knows. So I'm sure you can find love is all around Pennsylvania, New York, Vermont, Connecticut. So it's just like a new thing to read to your children. So I'm going to thank you for coming tonight and pass this around. You can't take the elementary school counselor out of me and take one of these for yourself. Yes?
I have a question for you.
Sorry, she's going to open a question. Singing. She's going to open.
She's
going to
open?
Yeah. I think we just did it, didn't we?
Very good thoughts. Very good.
Turn it off? Turn it off?
No.
Oh, they need the microphone. Okay.
Can I take my eraser first?
Yes. That takes all your negative thoughts away, the eraser. Yeah, we can do one or two questions, and then I guess. Why don't you be in charge of one or two questions? Okay.
Let me do doing. What do we have to do?
I just got coached by my mentor. So the protocol that I'm learning is that we will do the meditation, and then I'd be happy to take a question or two. That would be fine. But now I need the picture back up. Wait a minute. Ah, that's the one I wanted. So this will be our meditation because we know that guided imagery counts. And I believe, Daniel, we're going to dim the lights, put on quiet music, and I'm going to read you this beautiful meditation from Thich Nhat Hanh. And it's called Earth Touching. I don't know how many of you have looked at statues of the Buddha or paid attention to where the Buddha's hands are, but sometimes the Buddha is touching the earth. One hand is down on the earth. And I really think loving Mother Earth, paying attention to the earth is another good Valentine's Day practice. So let me turn my little light on. Okay. And then if you get comfortable and we have music from Daniel, then just take your deep breath and listen to the beautiful guided imagery. Okay, if you feel comfortable, close your eyes. Otherwise, you can just rest in this beautiful picture. Here we go. In gratitude, I bow to this land and all of the ancestors who made it available. I see that I am whole, protected, and nourished by this land and all of the living beings who have been here and with all their efforts made life easy and possible for me. I see George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, Abraham Lincoln, Dorothy Day, Martin Luther King Jr., and all the others known and unknown. I see all those who have made this country a refuge for people of so many origins and colors by their talent, perseverance, and love. Those who have worked hard to build schools, hospitals, bridges, and roads to protect human rights, to develop science and technology, and to fight for freedom and social justice. I see myself touching my ancestors of Native American origin, who have lived on this land for such a long time and know the ways to live in peace and harmony with nature, protecting the mountains, forest, animals, vegetation, and minerals of this land. I feel the energy of this land penetrating my body and soul, supporting and accepting me. I vow to cultivate and maintain this energy and transmit it to future generations. I vow to contribute my part in transforming the violence, hatred, and delusion that still lie deep in the collective consciousness of this society so that future generations will have more safety, joy, and peace. I ask this land for its protection and support. Thank you.
Based on the freeze technique slide, one of the last ones that we saw, and you said that in order for us to deal with a stressful situation, we should think about positive thought and ask your heart a question. My question is, should we think with our hearts or with our minds? It's always that conflict. So should we always think with our hearts? Or is that time when you actually have to forget about what your heart is telling you?
Well, I think our hope is that you can hear me?
Yes. Yeah.
I guess our hope, sometimes I call it our North Star, it's what we're trying to get to, is a nice communication between our heart and our mind. We really would like them to synchronize. And I think the effort we put into going to our heart, usually when we're under stress, our mind is spinning. So we want to get out of that particular state of mind by going to the heart and also learning to ask the heart for some help. It doesn't mean that as the thoughts settle and clear, we're not going to get some very positive thought that's going to say, go here, do this, talk to this person, let it go. And I guess my hope with this North Star image is that the two will get in sync, that we will be able to go to the heart, calm down, the heart will give its wisdom, and then it will be in synchronicity with the mind, the brain, I'm sorry, the mind, what? Mind, actually we get into little technical differences here. Divaldo Franco and Emmanuel talk about the mind as our state of consciousness, and then our brain as the transmitter of the thoughts, and then the heart as reflecting this good energy. So then hopefully then the mind will be settled and can help us out. I don't want to get us into like mind versus or brain versus heart, because that's kind of how we've been raised, you know, to always think our way through everything. And I think we just haven't tapped into the powerhouse that our heart is. And that intuition is so beautiful. And when they've done some research, it's been interesting. Events have been known ahead of their happening. It's all this Heart Math Institute research. And that means it only came through the wisdom and intuition of the heart. And already, the body was getting ready or something, because something was going to happen. The brain could never have gotten there. It had to be set up through this force field in the heart. Yeah.
Abby. This is just a comment. That was a wonderful presentation, Paula. And it was also a good testament of fighting your fear, not giving into your fear, doing something that really might scare you. If you have an idea of something that makes you really fearful, to just jump into it with all of your being, everything that you have, and just do it. And really, that was just a wonderful presentation. I think it was the best Valentine's present to receive.
We'll bump my heart again. Thank
you. I second that notion.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments? Okay.
Well, I'm just interested that you said the intuition was in the heart, And I've just always kind of heard, I guess, it's in your gut. Mm-hmm. Now, is that, like, where does the gut come into play with the heart, or are they very, very much the same?
No, I agree with you that I've heard that, too. Go with your gut.
Yeah.
I don't know, maybe as we keep going further, but considering we spent most of our waking minutes in our mind, in our brain, we're now going to finally, you know, get to some gut knowledge and some heart wisdom that I would think, again, they could be playing different roles. Like, usually my gut will tell me, is it safe or not? You know, it's like, that's such a big thing, is safety and security. We've got to preserve ourselves. We need to protect ourselves. It could be from emotional hurt, or it could be from something physical. But then somehow I just get the feeling that this beautiful intuition, which I think is a channel back to spirit, is somehow radiating through the heart. And I think then everything's got a role. And whatever works for us is what we're going to use next. And I think that's that word resonate again. Whenever a speaker presents different ideas, you're going to resonate, hopefully, with one or two that you're going to take with you. And that's going to be the biggest gift of any sharing we do like this. So we'll leave that question open. She's still back.
Oops. I didn't even raise my hand, but the intuition of Kirsten, and she gave me the microphone.
You must be in sync with each other.
No, I was thinking in the first exercise that you did with Kirsten, with the little heart, and you expressing to her your kind words. Sometimes we feel it. It's inside our heart. We feel this emotions and this kindness in our heart, but we don't know how to translate it into words. So there is any book, resource, website, whatever, something that is going to help us to start exercising how to say, how to express ourselves kindly?
Mm-hmm. Well, that could lead to another talk. There is language that we teach parents when they are really developing their parenting skills, and we call it the language of encouragement. And how we teach it is we give you the beginning of the sentence, like when I started out with, I really appreciate, you know, I value, and then you just let it happen. There's something that person did, said, or something. Or you could just say, I value you for being in my life. I don't want people to stress over this. And in the beginning, it's like someone learning to walk. When Doc Martin was given the task of saying something positive to his mate, he was stunned. It would be the same place. It's like, would somebody give me some words? Would somebody give me some, we call it sentence starters. And then we could go fill in the blank. And that's true, and it's okay. And it's so wonderful to be honest and share. So yes, there is a language called encouragement language, which differs from praise. Praise is like, good job, you know, good person, A+. And then encouragement language is really looking for something specific in the person. Like with Kirsten, I really appreciated the way she took her time, her generosity with that. And that's really helping the person value themselves even more than if I would have just said, thank you so much for saving me. I mean, that would have been praise, but it wouldn't have given her the behavior to reflect on and know that she's got as a skill. And that's why encouragement language is so good. It picks one specific behavior and it names it. And that's a powerful gift to give another person. Thanks.
Thank you.
Did Yasko have something?
Oh.
At least I observed that among, for us women, when we are in this turmoil, like you said, the mind gets offset, all this problem, the way we try to get out from that situation by wording, and instead getting better, of course, sometimes gets worse. So it seems we become just a mouth, you know?
Talking,
spitting or whatever. So many things. That's our way to release things, relief. For men, probably it's totally different.
It is different.
So how to be, to before we word and we expel all these things to help to calm down the mind, so you know. We don't get worse with the wordings.
I think you were with the children when we did heart lock-in. That was our first exercise. So, but what you're really saying is I have a stressed mind, so that's like freeze frame. The first step is really getting centered and calm rather than just being in that reactive mode, which is what human beings do. Something happens and we react. And then when Joanna de Angeles says we need to train our emotions, this is emotional training. So we just write it down, we put it in an emergency box, and we pull it out. So if we can just remember, I love this heart lock-in, just to breathe and go to our heart and rest in our heart, feel our heart. You can even, when you're quiet, of course you can hear your heart beating. And then nourish yourself first. And then I really think once you come back to the mind, you're in a different place. You can stop and think. You can use an I message, famous I messages, I feel frustrated, blah, when you, rather than you so-and-so. And just making that turn from a you statement to an I statement makes the biggest world of difference, because then the person's likely to hear you. But I think the very, very first step is catching yourself, and that is the tough one. But it's okay, because if you do the examine process, now I'll do a plug back to that exercise, and at the end of the day, you say to yourself, what was I grateful for? What was I not grateful for? Whoops, I didn't quite handle that one too well. And then you review it again, you're kind to yourself from the heart. You're training, 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 until one day it's automatic.
Paula, I actually have a question from an online viewer.
Really? For yes. First, I'm excited. I know they're out there.
His name from Facebook. Brian.
Facebook. I don't use that. Okay.
Brian's asking the question: what do you need to do to really love someone?
Oh wow! I feel like a Hallmark card now. I think it's really so simple is, again, just being with the person. I mean, how often do we just stop? I mean, couples like to hold hands and take walks, but if I just sat and I got into my heart and I was looking at you and feeling that love, that is so powerful. It's invisible. It's a transference of energy. It doesn't even need a word. I mean, the Hallmark greeting card is wonderful because I can put that away for a rainy day and I can read that when I need it after we've just had a disagreement. I'm not saying the card wasn't important, but the more little moments, why don't we call it like a mutual heart lock-in that we spend, that's really deepening love. And it'll be different too.
That's awesome. Thank you. Leo?
Just a quick, going back to Louise Hayes, when you mentioned her as well, and we often go through the processes of inflammation, and that certainly we can see this in our bodies too, you know, whenever we catch a cold and all those things. When we get to that point, you gave the some ideas on what to do not to get to that point of inflammation and all, but what to do when you're already there.
Well, you accept the fact you're there. That's the first step. You know, you can't say, oh boy, you're like, how could I have done that? I know better. How could I have gotten that sore throat, which is what I brought in with here, you know, this morning, which is why I've got my little pharmacy over here of herbal throat sprays. And I think it could have been nervousness too, but I really dealt with that. And I said, how did I get an inflamed throat? This is not right. I think it's back to acceptance again. As soon as I accept where I am, it doesn't matter if I've just been diagnosed with high blood pressure or anything, just accept it, because that's why we're here. again, none of us are perfect. You know, I had to do this metta, loving kindness, at the Easy Bank the other night, because when I drove in, a car drove in after me and jumped into the Easy Bank ahead of me. Now, I would hope that I'm evolved enough that that would have been okay. It wasn't. Because I was raised competitively. I was raised in a competitive society. I'm still working on cooperation. So here I am, and here's this poor teenager who jumps out of the car and is using the Easy Bank machine and is going, of course, on and on. And then I'm here and I start like walking, it's freezing. And then the light bulb goes off. Ah, what could you do right now? How about loving kindness? Oh. So I shifted out of this state of, you know, I don't want to be here. And all of a sudden, this teenager who was not feeling great either, I know this teenager could see me pacing and was not wanting to be that long at the Easy Bank machine. And I just said, you know, here is another soul who is struggling and wants to be happy. Here is another soul I can send loving kindness to. So, you know what made me feel really bad? When I finally looked at this teenager, she didn't have any hair and she was thin. I thought, now you've really done it. I'll bet she's in cancer treatment. And here you are having this moment of encounter, like, you know, spirit, the universe put me in this place. And I almost missed it. So thank goodness that I was getting ready for the talk. And now by sharing it with you, it might be my new Easy Bank procedure. So I sent her loving kindness, and she gave me the nicest smile and apologized to me when she was finished. So.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.